Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV, the YouTube channel for dog lovers. You know, I started this channel 10 years ago with bully breeds, and you know, I always wanted to be a source of great information and a great resource for the dog community. Today, I think I have an interview that's going to bring a lot of value to the dog community, and specifically the American Pitbull community. Today, I have an interview with a breed ambassador of the American Pitbull Terrier, a breed expert, breeder, and the creator of the Golden Vein Bloodline, Mr. Chico Lopez.
Hello, my friend. Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you, brother. Thank you so much for taking the time. And I'm very excited about the opportunity to sit down and talk to you. I've been following you for some time on social media. I know your passion. I know your commitment to the breed. And I know that you are a solid guy that has a lot of wonderful information that my audience, if they sit back, listen with an objectively with an objective mind and an open and academic understanding of the breed, they will find great value in what it is you have to say today.
Absolutely. I agree with you. I agree with you. I believe that the internet is full of a lot of misinformation and a lot of, you know, unfortunately, some people that do not know enough, they sometimes they think they know a lot. And so you have these guys that they might have good intentions, but they do not possess the knowledge or the inside information to be able to give the proper information. So that's one of the reasons why I decided to come and help you out with this interview, because I want to make sure that that we bring the best information, the most accurate information, and information that's meaningful, that is going to come in and give you an opportunity for you to actually learn and be able to love the dogs the way they're supposed to be loved.
Okay, brother. So let's get started. Let's start from the beginning. Please tell the world who you are and your relationship to the American Pit Bull Terrier.
Absolutely. My name is Chico Lopez, and I'm an American citizen. I'm from the United States. I live in Brazil right now. And I'm someone that, you know, you ask who's Chico Lopez in the different parts of different times in my life, you're going to find that I was just a 20-year-old boy that really wanted to have the best dogs in the world. Some people say that I'm the guardian of the breed. And one of the reasons why they say I'm the guardian of the breed is because I try to do things with excellence. I try to do things in a way that are always going forward, moving into the right direction in the American Pitbull Terrier world. So I protect the purity and the highest standard, the highest quality of the American Pitbull Terrier as a dog, as a pet, as a companion, as someone that you can love and understand exactly how the American Terrier was built. So I've been an ambassador of the breed from the very beginning because of the way I handle myself. But I've also been an ambassador of the breed because I traveled to 17 countries, and 28 countries, and in 17 different cities, I actually give seminars about the breed. People got together, we went to universities, auditoriums, and we talk about what is really the American Pitbull Terrier, how the American Pitbull started. You know, you go to countries like we went to Jakarta, Indonesia, or when we were in Moscow in Russia, or when we were in Asuncion, Paraguay, or in Quito, Ecuador, or Lima, Peru, or in Brazil, or in Mexico. And what we do is we tell people what is the real American Pitbull Terrier. The American Pitbull Terrier has an incredible amount of fans of the American Pitbull Terrier. They do that. They believe they have the right dog. And today we are going to unpack, you know, what is the real American Pitbull Terrier? And so as an educator and a historian of the breed, I dedicated my life, 30 years of my life, with a tremendous passion and lived a very, very fast life. I did some things with the dogs that it'll take people two lifetimes to do them, sometimes in 2 or 3 months. So we traveled to 76 cities around the world, and we help people, we taught people, we teach people. What is the real American Pitbull Terrier, the benefits of owning an American Pitbull Terrier, sometimes over other breeds. So I am someone that protects the American Pitbull Terrier and protects the real standard of it. What is the real American Pitbull Terrier? And that is the question.
Okay, perfect, perfect. So before we get started with I want to please tell me, like, who brought you into the breed? Who were some of your mentors that got you on, got you off on the right foot and dealing with the American Pitbull Terrier?
I think that's a great question. Who were my mentors? I believe that having the right mentoring sheep in anything you do is important. And before I got into the dogs, my background was, I was always wanted to be a winner. To be a winner, you have to be a competitor. But there's a lot of people that are very happy with just competing, right? And so I wanted to have the very best dog in the world. I wanted to own the most powerful dog in history. And for me to do that, I had to learn and study the dogs and everything else. So as a young man, I had the wrong knowledge. I had the knowledge that everybody else had. The first dog that I had was a neighborhood pit bull, just like most people have. The United States has, I believe they say, 20 million dogs that are called pit bulls. And just a handful of them are actually real American Pitbull Terriers. The majority of them are dogs that have sparkles of the real American Pitbull Terrier. Some of them have a look that goes back to the American Pitbull Terrier. And that's why it's so easy to confuse the dogs. So when I started the dogs, I went with that kind of mentality. Yeah, I recall that I met a person, Mr. Ralphie, and it was someone that it was instrumental for me at that moment, because I would have gone into these big head dogs where they were measuring the heads and everything. And I remember looking at a magazine that was supposed to be about real American Pitbull Terriers, and they were advertising these dogs that are not real pit bulls. So even the people that make the magazine were confused with what is a real pit bull. And so I think I was blessed that this man sent me on that direction and told me, look, this is the real American Pitbull Terrier. This is the way to go. And that's not the way to go. And I believe that that essence, that part right there, is something that in a short moment, he created something inside me that today I tell millions of people what is the real American Pitbull Terrier and which is the right way to go. So there's many stories that go along with it and how I help people. So my vision and my mission for the breed is a little bit different than the men that actually were available to me when I started the dogs, because we're talking about mentors. So I've never really had someone that's doing what I'm doing right now for the breed. Unfortunately, I never had someone that can help me and guide me and say, look, Chico, this, don't do this or do that, or this is better, or let me teach you this or let me teach you that. There's always someone that's trying to teach you how they do it. But the problem is that themselves as role models are not that winner that I was talking about. They were just people that had dogs, but their knowledge was not profound. They learned something from somebody else. And, you know, back in the 90s, that reflection of some of the most common quotes in the American Pitbull Terrier world, people that know American Pitbull Terrier world is, you know, good dogs are where you find them. And so I wouldn't want to have that kind of mentoring of where good dogs are where you find them. Imagine that the guy that said, I believe, was Eric Tudor, you know, and this guy's owned 60, 100, 200 dogs back then in the 1950s. And you have the dogs, but good dogs are where you find them. So in other words, he'll go somewhere else and see somebody else's dog that was better than all the dogs he had in the yard, and he'll bring them and he changed them, and he go from one bloodline to the next bloodline, from one dog to the next dog. And of course, I understand that that was the developing part of the breed. So I'm not gonna punish anybody for that, or I'm not gonna say that I'm superior to them on that. I really, that's what the times that we're living on. So when I came from the world of drag racing. And in drag racing, I learned quickly to look at the winners. I am a super fan of goats. So I'm always looking at goats. I want the goats to be my mentors. I'm a super, you know, I don't watch basketball, but I love to talk about Michael Jordan and about the other guys that are great. Kobe Bryant, all these guys, LeBron James. I'm not the kind of guy that's, you know, going to hate LeBron James over Michael Jordan. I'm going to like both of them, and I'm going to say that both of them are great, right? But I'm gonna find who was the one that had more leadership, and I'm gonna give LeBron James a chance to develop himself. When it comes to guys like Tom Brady, that kind of stuff really calls my attention. I want to know why, you know, this guy came from the position. You know, I think he was the sixth round draft pick on the what's the name of it, NFL. And I think he was the 199th person that they selected. So I look at a guy like that and how people did not measure the side of his heart, which will go in the future questions. But, you know, for me, having a mentor, I didn't find this Michael Jordan in the American Pitbull Terrier. I didn't find this Kobe Bryant. I didn't find this Messi or Pelé or Maradona in the American Pitbull Terrier. What I saw was a field of people that were very comfortable with the environment and the things we were doing. So I walk into the real world of the real American Pitbull Terrier. Remember, the first dog that I had was a pet, and it's a pet from a neighborhood dog. But in this neighborhood, I walk into someone that really had access to the very best dogs in the era. You know, I was in the Bronx, New York. And so he did mentor me in terms of giving me things that I capture and were in essence. As far as everything else that he knew, condition, everything else, it was completely obsolete to me. And that's one of the reasons I had to develop myself. That was one of the reasons why I had to, develop myself. And I will say that later on, a few years later, VA, which is someone that was very important in the dogs, a personal friend of mine today, I will say that he has some, at that particular point, has some good advice for me, and I really I treasure that. But who is my mentor as a whole? It is my dogs. My experiences with the dogs actually revealed things for me that the other guys were not able to understand. They were listening to each other, and they were all at one level. And for me, I there was too much noise, and it was not, they were not Jordans. So there was really, everybody was, the best guys were like maybe shoulders above their head, the other guys' heads. I wanted to be something big. And I saw in the American Pitbull Terrier the capacity. These dogs were not being maximized to be the best they can be. So I had to become that person. And during that process, I became Chico Lopez. During that process, I learned what I learned. And today, my mission and my vision is to preserve the very best American Pitbull Terrier for whatever limited time we have with the breed, which is an extinction, by the way. And my mission is to connect the greatest human possible. And that's a good question, because my mission is to take the celebrities, the GOATs and the Hall of Famers and the people involved in sports to own these dogs, to raise their children with these dogs, to lift the families up. You know, at the same time, I also have the idea that there are heroes out there that they are not famous, but they are great heroes. I give you a perfect example. I have a hero that owns a dog by the name of Ernie. And he's a hardworking guy. You know, we call him and his daughter and myself, when we first talked, he said, is your dad like a Dickie guy type of guy? Like, you know, he comes home with Dickies. Yes, okay, I love those guys. And he's a hero for his family and his wife and the kids. We become very good friends. When I took this dog to him and his gift as a gift, it was his birthday gift. He came and he said, this is the first time in 53 years that I got what I wanted on my birthday. And, you know, his kids and his wife got it for him. It was a surprise. That was powerful. And then another guy I have, Joey, in Texas. And Joey is a hardworking guy, Mexican descendant. And he's a really hardworking guy, very Christian, a tremendous heart, sent me a lot of quotes from the Bible. He shows me a lot of love. And they have a small little dog, and he bought Summers for me to raise his son. He has three daughters, and he has a son now, and he wants his son to have the masculinity, to be a real macho, and have this influential influence from this dog, from Chico Lopez. And so my mentors is these experiences that shaped me to be the man who I am. Yes, I observe what some men did in the past, and I have nothing but respect for those men. I believe that for you to get to some place, somebody in the back was helping you and promoting you. But there's some of the people as well were doing some things that I didn't agree with. So I make my own history, and I became my own mentor. My mentors is the mentality of these GOATs. And so I had the GOATs people. Now I created the GOAT dogs. So now I have the gold dogs, and I have a blueprint in my head. It's a metrics of what is the best dogs to mentor me. Beautiful thing talking about mentors. My dogs, and this is a very important part of this interview, my dogs are mentors that can mentor a child, that can mentor a person. Look at Chris Cyborg, the Grand Slam champion of MMA, got the only person in the world that got the four belts. You know, she's an animal lover, got a pig, Manny Pacquiao, got Fedor, which is the Labrador she has, and got a dog from Miko Holly. And she sleeps with the dog, trains with the dog. I mean, this is the best experience she ever had with an animal. And she, at the beginning, she didn't know she was gonna have that experience. So she got something way bigger than what she was expecting. That is becoming that man. That idea was my mentor.
Nice, nice. Well, let's talk about the essence of the dog. What is a real American Pitbull Terrier? And please explain to me your concept of the velvet and steel.
Wow, you're throwing me a lot of questions in one. You pack them up in there and you throw me a lot of questions in one. This is it's going to be a long reply that is going to be beautiful and everything. I think I'm going to start backwards in order for me to tell you. I'm going to talk a little bit on the first question. I'll go into the last question secondly. The real American Pitbull Terrier is that dog that is connected to the real American Pitbull Terrier from the day of creation. In other words, has a lineage connection to the very first bloodlines in the 1800s and the 1900s, and it has an interrupted connection of these great men's, these great people that actually breed these dogs. And I'm not talking about any breeder. I'm talking about the CEOs. You know, these men that maybe we can talk a little bit about later, but we call them dogmen. Not everybody that called themselves dogmen, and I can explain to you what that is later, but these men were able to shape this special animal. They discovered things about the dogs. And those things, they have a similarity when it comes to humans, which is fantastic. And that's why these dogs can connect in ways with humans that only those that actually own them can understand them. And I'm not talking about the common pit bull, because I owned the common pit bull before, but I understood that if I wanted to go better, I had to obtain better dogs. And then I had to create my own bloodline and create my own dogs that were superior to the dogs where they came from. Because the American Pitbull Terrier is a bloodline, is a continuous growing process. It continues changing, it continues getting better. And when it comes to genetics and the process of developing and some sort of self-molding and I don't know if I should call it evolution process, but I like to call it that, something that we can control, it is a beautiful thing. So what is an American Pitbull Terrier? The question is, and a lot of the things that I'm going to say here to you, pay attention, that I'm going to tell you from a point of being a historian. So I'm not saying that I support what happened in the past, but at the same time, I'm not going to say that I spit on it, okay? So because these were things that were done by the great-grandfathers of the country, of the United States. And some of the things that I'm going to mention, they come on different dates and different things, different events. So I'm only tapping as a historian and a book writer, I'm only touching history as I tell you this. The dogs came originally not as American Pitbull Terrier. They came as half and a half mixed breed. They call them pit dogs. And those dogs came from countries like Ireland and England, okay? And as they came from those countries, they came by boat, by ship. And they took them, not in a small boat, but actually a transoceanic ship that was and sailing from the old continent to the Americas. And you got to keep in mind and think about how expensive it is to have freight on a boat, on a ship like that. When you transport something by land, they charge you by the weight, by the size. You know, you go to FedEx, you go to DHL, you want to send a package. The heavier it is, the bigger the box, the more you pay, because you're paying for transportation. So imagine that these men were leaving their old country to come into the Americas, into the United States specifically. And they were coming with a dream. They had a dream to come to a better place, to work hard and provide things for the family, to become rich if they can. And they brought their children, they brought their wives, and they brought the very few things that they can bring with them. But they also brought a small kennel boxes made out of wood when they had these beautiful dogs that are the great-grandparents of the American Pitbull Terrier. So these dogs, they understood they were not human eaters or people killers or anything like that. They were comeback dogs that actually behave very well among people. And that is the root of the American Pitbull Terrier. Warriors that came, they defended themselves, and they were animals that provided a lot of influence to the children and to those men. It was part of the life they lived. It was part of the culture of those times. You know, people can actually see movies and things on TV about Vikings and stuff like that. That's history. When you talk about the American Pitbull Terriers, I'm talking right now, it's just history. That's how it was back then. So those were the dogs of the 1700s. As they developed those dogs, and they actually were started to become American Pitbull Terriers of the United States without having the name yet, those dogs were mostly raised by two type of people. Very important part. Some of the people that were raising them, they were gamblers that wanted to see that their dog can defend the bet. And that dog could have been the chain dog that is in the chain, living there in the chain for the whole life. And it was an animal, an instrument to win a bet. Because that instrument to win a bet, that created an animal that it was always better than the next one, better than the next one, because they were looking for that better dog that can defend that bet, that money, right? And in the other hand, you have men that care about, yes, having a performance dog that was better, but they wanted to protect a bloodline. They wanted to protect their last name on that dog. And so they grew very much attached to that dog. Their children were attached to the dog. And that developed something that is so beautiful. That developed something that is the base of the American Pitbull Terrier, and is the concept of the dog of velvet and steel. Beautifully explained, and the first time I learned it, he might learn it from someone else, but, and I even asked him for permission for me to use the word, dogs of velvet and steel, was Mr. Bob Stevens. I'm not a heavy book writer. I like to listen more than read books, but I do read some books. His book came to my hands at an early time, and I will tell you this. Dogs made out of velvet and made out of steel. Think about the guys that were coming on the ships. Those dogs were dogs made out of velvet and steel back then. They were nice to the children, and they were warriors in their own level. And as they developed in America, those dogs, especially those men that were working to develop dogs for their family, those dogs will spend time with the men like no other breed can. They were going through a special process of training and conditioning for 3 to 4 months. And something that I always love till today, my dogs is going for a walk, is putting them on a training process where the dog really enjoys to walk with me, to go out swimming, to come back home. The dogs actually do love this. And they also love to be among people and among children. My dogs can be your pillow and can also be your training partner. That's why they are so great for people, for families that have children. They are so great for people that actually like to run and train and condition. And also this same dog can be a pillow. Chris Cyborg, for instance, there's pictures and videos where she's sleeping and the dog is her pillow. And then after that, they are training. The dog is like tapping her. Let's go train. Let's go condition. Why these dogs are like this is that process of developing the breed. No other breed has 180 plus years where if you come to only on that line, only in that straight line of a pedigree connection, the fewer men you have, the better. If you have between 1990, between the 1900s and 2021, if you have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 men, 3 is too little, but 6, 7 men, then the bloodline might be pretty good, because there were men that actually worked, each one of them, the dogs for 30, 40 years, and they probably developed. If the men actually stuck to the same thing he had, and that dog is actually performing very well. So what happens is, think about the American Pitbull Terrier as no other breed you can think of. Think about a table where you have a pedestal for the table, right? Where the table is gonna sit, the flat part of the table is gonna sit. And think about this pedal having two columns. And one column, to be the perfect breed, is made out of steel, and the other one is made out of velvet. Both of them work together very well. If one fail, if not being the dog of velvet fail, then the part of steel will also fail, because this man discovered something very important back then. And this happens probably in other breeds as well. They discover that the best comeback dogs, the best warrior dogs, were the dogs that were great to families and great to children. Those dogs were the better dogs. And they discover that the dogs that actually were mean and stuff like that to people, they actually didn't have a heart inside them. They actually didn't have a high level of, I want to finish this and I want to win. So the very smart, clever man understood that the better the pet it was, the better the warrior it was. And it doesn't happen in any other breed. They were connected. They were interconnected. They become, these two columns become a single column and made these dogs out of velvet and steel. The deeper the connection with the human, the deeper the connection with the human, usually the better steel dog you have. I will never get attracted to the breed if the breed were only made out of steel, like this powerful dog that can do this, but you got to be afraid. No. My dogs are first and most extremely great with the family, but at the same time, they're extremely made out of steel, coming in from the work that was done many years ago and how the dogs actually outperform everyone by numbers, by everything. So I believe that from the very beginning, one of the things that I wanted to create was I wanted to make better the dog of velvet and steel. And that was a little bit of a formula that came to me on a flash, like a snap picture, and I knew velvet and steel is the formula. I have children, I raise my children with my dogs. And so I created some dogs that through 30 years of selecting the dogs that will eat you by kissing you and hugging you and loving you. You go to my Instagram account at realchicolopez.com. I mean, at realchicolopez, and you'll find videos of my friend, he's driving and the dog came through the side and started licking him and kissing him, and he's listening to music and the dog never stops. This dog here is a hardworking dog. He loves to go out there at work and he loves to go out there to hunt. You know, they take him hunting pigs, hogs, hog hunting. They go do that hunting, and the dog is just a tremendous dog. Has a dog that's better than other breeds, has a tremendous power in his mouth, has a tremendous stamina, has a tremendous drive. He doesn't quit. He continues working, has a tremendous air in his lungs, and he knows how to work with a way bigger than him hog. So that dog right there is a dog that is out of velvet and steel. Now, this particular thing of velvet and steel is one of the reasons why some people think I got the real pit bull, you know, because the coloration might be correct and the dog might be the best pet. And that's what happened to me. The first dog that I ever had was a tremendous pet. And this dog had those sparkles of the real pit bull. And that's what happens when you dilute and water down the bloodlines. The dogs out there in the community, the guys that don't know anything about the real pit bull, they end up having a puppy that loves them, that kisses them. And they say, oh, this is a pit bull. Then later on, they deform them. They make them bigger heads, shorter legs. And the dog is still is loving, you know, but there are other factors that are very important in having a real American pit bull terrier. They are lost and washed on the breeding process, on the selection process. So the real American pit bull terrier is actually exactly that. The best, most soft velvet you can come. And I'll give you a perfect example. People that owned previously American Pit Bull Terriers, their fathers had American Pit Bull Terriers. They were raised with American Pit Bull Terriers. They swear they had the best dogs in the world. And somehow they don't have dogs anymore. And then we become friends. Some call me, whatever. They're good people. They own companies. They're not like some thugs or anything like that. Excuse me. And then the guys get my dogs and they're like, 6 months, 9 months, a year passed, and the guy will call me and says, Chico, can I tell you something? You created something very special. We never had a dog like this. The dog that you have is extremely loving, loves to go out there with the cattle, the cows, go away with the cows and help us in the ranch, and he's the most durable dog we ever had. but he also is the most loving dog we ever have. We never were able to connect with these with our dogs the way we connect with your dog. Your dogs are extremely smart. And so to me, that combination is part of the real American Pitbull Terrier, but it's only part. In order to be a real American Pitbull Terrier, this dog had to be connected to the parents, must be really special. And the grandparents must be really special. And the grand uncles, the grand aunties, and everyone around this dog is like a matrix, like a ball of fire, full of greatness and excellence. That is the real American Pitbull Terrier, when everything around is built out of excellence. Not in a scattered dog that is, you know, one in a thousand. Because, like I said before, they wanted to have these dogs that they said before, you know, good dogs are where you find them. I said, wow, so I got to have 200 dogs to have a real great dog? I said, no. You asked me a question today and you said me, where are good dogs? And I said, good is the enemy of great. I learned that by reading, of course. Good is the enemy of great. You know, people don't have a great something because they settle for a good something. And so they're happy with this good car, good house, good neighborhood, good life or whatever. They don't want to have a great one. And when it comes to dogs, I am a master of greatness. I want to have great genetics, great temperament, great pedigree, the greatest possible. So how do I know if this dog is a real pit bull? How do I know if this dog is out of velvet and steel? The question is very simple. The most important question that I'll ask anybody, who do you got the dog from? The man behind the dog is the only one that can create a great American Pit Bull Terrier. And it doesn't happen because the pedigree, blah, blah, blah. No. You might get lucky with having a good dog by pedigree and stuff like that, but you're not going to have a great one. A great one has to have a family. If you have a really a spectacular dog without a family, you don't have nothing to go forward with. And that's exactly what happened to me when I started with my dog that was my first dog that I ever got. I love this dog. And this dog had nothing around him that was special. He had the sparkles, really powerful sparkles of, and he sold me the idea. I purchased the idea from him that I wanted to dedicate my life to the American Pitbull Terrier and to develop the breed. I entered the dogs. I saw the landscape. I saw the people involved. I didn't see this CEO level of mentality. And I said, I will take these dogs to levels that never been created before. And I did that. And so what happens is the real American Pitbull Terrier can only come from a great family of real American Pitbull Terriers, from a great man that has a great pedigree of knowledge, of influence. And it doesn't mean that the man has been in the dogs for 30, 40, 50 years. Because, you know, somebody can have 1 year, you know, 30 years of doing something, but only 1 year of experience and 29 years of repetition. So, and we go back to who was your mentor? Who do you learn from? And if you learn from a bricklayer, nothing wrong with bricklayers. I love him. I have a few friends bricklayers. But if, just to give you an example, to give you an understanding, if you learn from a bricklayer that is a great bricklayer, how to lay bricks, and that person taught somebody else and somebody else and somebody else, you know, you go down the line, you're not going to have an architect. You got to have profound knowledge. You got to have profound understanding and profound experience to be able to reach that level. You understand that? So how do you get a real American Pitbull Terrier? Find the right person. Find the right family. And when you have the dog, there has to be everything around it. Most people that buy a dog from me, they buy it because they go on the internet and they say, Chico, you have the most beautiful dogs I ever seen in the world. And I say, you know what? I think to myself, hey, Jesus, man. I did all of this for nothing. I did all of this greatness. They buy them because they're beautiful. But then I understand something. That the beauty is a byproduct of my work.
Beautiful, beautiful story. Hey, let me ask you this. One of the things that also defines the breed is this concept of gameness. A lot of people, a lot of dogmen have a different understanding and the way that they define greatness, I mean, gameness. How do you, as a American Pitbull Terrier expert, define the word gameness?
I'm going to help you out with two ways. You said a lot of dogmen, and that'll be a topic by itself. You know, I don't have the same understanding of dogmen as other people have, and obviously other people don't have the same experience around the world that I have into what is a dogmen. There's a huge difference, and I'll touch this in a different moment about what is a dogmen and so on and so forth. But I'll assume that you're trying to tell me that a lot of people are breeders and people that are involved in dogs and dog fanciers, okay, are having a different opinion on what's gameness. Let me tell you this about gameness. Gameness is the heart of the United States. Gameness is the heart of those people that never give up. And gameness come in different levels. And somebody's gonna say gameness is the willingness to give up your universal right to survival. In other words, rather than survive, you'd rather die to complete the mission. And that sounds very novel, and that sounds very up there, very super, like duper duper, like wow, oh my God. But mostly, most of the people that say those words, they do not have that on their dogs. I promise you that. They don't have that in their dogs. They wish they did, but they don't. The majority, they wish they did. And I don't want to, you know, I'm not saying that everybody out there, this might get some people a little bit crazy, but if you don't have if you don't have those dogs, those legends by the bunches, by the little, how do you call it? Buckets of gray dogs that you made, you create, you did everything by yourself, you really don't have that, okay? So gameness comes in different levels, okay? And gameness is in the heart of the United States because, and that is very important, it attaches to the American Pitbull Terrier. I always used to say the American Pitbull Terrier is the first dog in the United States. In fact, is the Fox Terrier or the Fox Hound in Virginia was a dog that was defined as a breed before the American Pitbull Terrier back in the 1700s or 1800s, something like that. Don't quote me on that. But the American Pitbull Terrier is evident that is today with over 20 million so-called Pitbull or Pitbull type dogs in the United States and now it's spread all over the world, especially in Latin America, is insane. You know, you walk in the streets of any of the Latin American countries, you find some dog that somebody call a pit bull. And so these people, these dogs were the mirror. A dog is a mirror match of the man. And when I was in the Bronx and I was 20 years old, the dog you had, the man you were. I'm walking on the street and I see somebody walking with a Rottweiler. That's a tough guy. You see somebody walking, you know, with a Frenchie. Whoa, mamma mia, how are you, my friend? You know, this guy is a little funny. And that's how it used to be. I'm not saying that's how it is today, but I'm talking quoting back the past, right? So the dog you had is the dog you, the man you are. There was a reflection of your soul. So those men back then were raised by a very tough dog. And that's why those children, those entrepreneurs back then were very tough people and they were winners. They didn't want to be someone that just participated and get a participation diploma. They wanted to get a winner diploma. You understand? They wanted to get the prize, number one. You know, they always thought the number two was first loser, you know, opposite of what the culture today is, that anyone that went in, no matter how it went, because he put a great effort, that guy gets a recognition, you know? And no, there is, you win, or you lose, simple as that. So gameness has a lot to do with that. Gameness has to do with never give up. So when you look at Winston Churchill and he's walking to the, you know, talking to the troops that are going to Normandy, he's telling them, never, never, never give up. That's gameness. But gameness come in different levels because the gameness can be manifested on your will to win, not your will to survive. Is just your will to win. People confuse the will to survive with the will to win, the will to conquer. And so there are people today that have showcased and showed this gameness. You look at the people today, I'm gonna call them out. Look at Davy Goggins, you know, nothing can hurt me. You know, Davy Goggins, look him up, buy his book, read his book. This is an American Pitbull Terrier made into a human being, okay? This brother here is just amazing. You got to buy his book. You got to read his book. You got to illustrate yourself. Get the mindset of this man. apply it to your life, and you will have a little bit of a pit bull. That is David Goggins. You look at Royce Gracie, that is gameness. People like to see the two warriors going into each other, Canelo Alvarez versus Triple G in boxing. And when you have these two guys here, they go 24 rounds, and you still, some people might have some doubt. For me, it was clear. Canelo won both fights. Maybe for me, he won both fights. Anyhow, but you look at guys like Masvidal. He called himself Masvidal because that's the así como hablamos los latinos, Masvidal. But he's Masvidal, and Masvidal has a tattoo around his neck. He's not new. He always had it. He's from the streets. He's a great guy, and he says game bread. Game bread has a lot to do with it. That means he says that he was like an animal, like a rooster or like a pit bull. I can only think that a pit bull, he might know something about pit bulls, and that he will never quit. I just saw him lost the other day with this other guy from Nigeria, Usman, and he got knocked down like on the first round. The way he got up and how happy he was, even though he lost, and how he, when he was on TV, he told his children, I just got a mosquito bite, that is fine, I'll see you in just a little bit. You know, I look at that, that's gameness. That guy is his mentality. You know, he's willing to go to the extreme, to the knockdown, get knocked out, get up, smile about it, and continue. Gameness is attached to the American culture. The boxers of the past, they wanted to have game dogs. You look at John Sullivan, the first boxer, I believe, first heavyweight champion, I think it is, from England, maybe of the United States, I'm not quite sure right now. He had American Pitbull Terriers. He loved them. You look at Jack Johnson, the first Afro-American world champion, superstar, and these men had them. You look at Jack Dempsey, which is the how do you call it, the inspiration of Mike Tyson. He had them. And it is so beautiful that these men that were very game, that were super game, had this inspiration. Today, a lot of this new society, because since the 40s till now, you fill up those buckets with a whole bunch of dogs that are not real pit bulls. XL is not a real pit bull. Blue dogs is not a real pit bull. Blue nose is not a real pit bull. All these dogs that are not real pit bulls, you know, these dogs cannot inspire these guys to own a real American Pit Bull Terrier, because they don't have this thing about gameness at that level. So these guys will go, and instead of having a dog, they'll have their girlfriend's dog. You know, two Chih Tzus, you know, maybe a Chihuahua, maybe a Frenchie, something like that, because they don't connect with that particular dog. So what is gameness? Gameness is never giving up, and it does come in levels. It comes in levels that you could not believe. So the very top of it, I'll give it to you right now. Here we go. In the center of America's culture, America's living, people that are deep in their going against demons, going against inner demons, I'm saying, going against adversity, COVID-19, going against not having a job, a wife that got divorced, a single father that's raising children. All these people, they need to have this support. And many times they feel themselves like they are an underdog in life. Sometimes they feel like they need to fight very hard and not give up in order for them to make it. The fireman that has to look at the fire to save that child, he walks through it, that's gameness. When he goes out there and he gives his life. So going to the underdog is that the person that is suspected that's going to lose the fight. But today is used in a position where the underdog is going to lose on a bet, betting side. Bets always come with American Pitbull Terriers and always come with that. You don't have to, when it comes to the American Pitbull Terrier, the gift of the idea of an underdog was created by the American Pitbull Terrier. The American Pitbull Terrier, you had, I'm going back to the 17, 1800s. Remember, United States was created in 1776, the year of independence. So the Pitbull Terrier or the grandparents of the Pitbull Terriers were always being around Americans. So American Pitbull Terrier is part of the America. You know, these guys were not walking a Chihuahua. These guys were not walking a Shih Tzu. These men back there, they were not doing that. So whenever these dogs were in combat, and I'm calling history, whenever these dogs were in combat, they were totally exhausted, dog A and dog B. Back then, the dog that was at the bottom, it was called the underdog. This underdog right here. And these dogs were separated, and they'll go at each other again to prove who has the heart, who has the gameness to continue. And when the dog that was at the bottom, a lot of people will say the dog has gameness. The dog that's at the bottom has gameness. And that dog is going to win and say, I go with the underdog, and the underdog will win. So that created that word of underdog that is used by you and everyone else in the United States. Every television channel during the day, they'll talk about some underdog. So the American Pitbull Terrier is still embedded in the American lingo, because anything that has to do with never give up, it is an American Pitbull Terrier. Therefore, people use the word Pitbull in recklessly. You know, there is a singer, which I love his music. I love his persona. I love him as a leader. I think he's a great guy. He's a Cuban guy. Last name Perez, I believe. And he calls himself Pitbull. Matter of fact, the people that work with Pitbulls have been so weak through these breeders and these leaders and in the Pitbull communities, all divided with dogs that are not real Pitbulls. They're being so weak that a guy that became a singer, he used his name Pitbull for some reason. Maybe he's related, never give up. Because the guy is like that. The guy's an influencer. And he talks about winning and everything in life. Maybe he used the name Pitbull. I don't know. Maybe I'm almost sure that he did, because he wants to call himself someone that never gives up, right, in life. So this guy fought like a Pitbull through his life, and he called himself Pitbull. You Google the word Pitbull, and the first thing you'll find is this very nice singer. So Pitbull, you know, I saw some guys, royal, you know, realtors, Pitbulls. I called them up and said, hey, guys, what do you call yourselves, real, you know, realtor Pitbull? Said, we will never give up until we find the home that you want. Oh, okay, that's very good, very nice. And so this word Pitbull, they attach it to 180 pounds, 120-pound dog, and they call it the giant Pitbull. Not a Pitbull, absolutely. But a guy, you know, I'm not going to knock the guy. I'm not here to knock anybody's hustle, but he built up something with a name that's attached to gameness. And the gameness that he measures is not attached to the descendants. That dog is not descending of the warriors. It's just a dog that they created. And might be a different breed, and they have a niche of people that really like them, and I think it's great and everything. The one thing I don't agree with, that's not a real Pitbull. And so the guys, they have very good intentions. They have this XL, double XL, and they have their websites. I remember that back in 2010, you know, when I didn't want to sell Pitbulls to anybody, and I was in this world, and a very good friend of mine that worked in NASA, is an engineer. He told me, he said, Chico, wouldn't you sell a dog to yourself? And I thought about it, and I said, I would. He said, there's a lot of people like that in the world that it could be just like you, maybe better than you. And I said, wow, Jesus, you're right. But how can I find those guys? And I wanted to create a website that was called Exclusive Pitbulls, because my dogs are very exclusive, right? And nobody would look for exclusive real American Pitbull Terrier. So I called it, I want to put the cookies on the lower shelf. And see, the breed is actually called American Pitbull Terrier. That was actually named like that, you know, and very important about the name, because the first thing they selected was American. They wanted to make sure that it was American. They wanted to make sure that the process was the pit, which are the dogs used to be in combat. And they wanted to make sure that the dogs were represented on these half and half dogs, you know, half terrier, half bulldog. So we called it American Pit Bull Terrier. And these dogs with this gameness is very important. People take these dogs and they call anything Pitbull. Somebody called me and said, hey, how are you, Mr. Lopez? I want to buy a Pitbull. What price do you have? I said, can I give you a price? You don't even know the dogs I have. You know, there's maybe 150 different type of dogs you call Pitbulls. And, you know, they have nothing to do with a real Pitbull. So you need to understand what is gameness. You need to understand what is a real Pitbull. A real Pitbull is attached to gameness. United States, the beautiful flag, is attached to gameness. The soldiers, these doctors that didn't see their families for months, that's called gameness. You got to go for your mission, okay? You got to be willing to lose, but you put everything on the fire to make it happen. So that is the American Pitbull Terrier, my friend. That is gameness. Gameness is going further than anybody can. You understand? And I'm going to tell you now that we are in the topic of gameness. I'm going to tell you something that I'm going to, it's two stories in one. You know, I like animals, I like goats and everything. So my favorite goat when it comes to horses, for instance, my favorite goat is the greatest of all time, Secretariat. And for you guys that are there, you can go rent the movies and horses. I would recommend you to get Secretariat, and I would recommend you to get Seabiscuit. Two different horses. One was the baddest horse because it had the right dimensions. He was bigger. His stride was longer than anybody. And the other one was a smaller horse that win because he had a tremendous heart. Both of the horses had a tremendous heart. When Secretariat passed away, they opened him up and they found out that his heart was twice or three times the heart of a normal horse. One of my clients took one of my dogs to the vet and find out the heart is bigger than the normal dog. All my dogs have their heart is a little bigger than the normal dog. And I'll give you a story about a guy that I really appreciate this guy. I'm pretty sure I'm not going to say the story like him. He's a genius. His name is Patrick Ben David. And if you want to follow his channel, you can follow him. I think he's a tremendous genius and entrepreneur. And the story that he's saying is going to impact you because he puts it in a way that applies to humanity. So the story goes like this. It's a story about a horse, about horses, race horses. And there's this man, Egyptian, multi-millionaire, and he loved horses, okay? And he contracted someone. His name is Syed. He contracted a guy, I think, by the name of Jeff. It was a very smart guy that was working on the stock market and playing numbers and looking at statistics and looking at numbers and metrics and stuff like this, a genius guy. And this guy retires and now he looks at horses, like horses. And then he makes his own formula and how pick up a horse to win and how to pick up a horse as a baby, as a young yearling, and to be a prospect to become a prize thoroughbred horse. Because you know, my dogs are like thoroughbred dogs, okay? So this man, Syed, contract this man, they go out in an auction, and this man, Syed, is going to sell some horse and buy some horse, okay? So he's selling something that he have, and he's buying something from somebody else. So he take this man, and the man is looking at the horses, come back to him and says, I have bad news for you. There's nothing else for you. I wouldn't recommend you to put a dollar on any of these horses. He said, really? Nothing? Not a horse? Are you sure? He said, no. But what I would recommend you is that horse of yours, that you brought to the auction, you need to buy it back. He said, that the horse that I brought to the auction that I already sold, you want me to get that horse? Why? I got rid of it. And he said, let me explain to you something. That horse is 56, 57 percentile on high. You know, percentile means, you know, if you tell your children it's like a 90 percentile, that means out of 100 kids, 90% of the children are going to be smaller than your son, okay, or your daughter. And so that in weight, in total size, the horse was like 60 percentile to the other horses. But the left ventricle, the pedigree, 71 or 72% percentile. That means his pedigree was crappy. It was nothing special in pedigree. He was nothing special in size. He was nothing special to look at. He was just another Seabiscuit, right? But this man, he says, his left ventricle is 99.6%. I might be a little wrong on the numbers, but I'm like right there. 99.6% percentile on the heart. That means this horse has a tremendous heart. That's gameness. Has a tremendous heart. And that's what takes to win. In the year of 2015, I believe, that horse won something that hasn't been won for 30 years in the United States and anywhere in the world. He won the Triple Crown. That horse was named American Pharaoh. El Faraón de América. Faraón de América. America's Pharaoh. And this horse not only won this competition, but a few months later or a few weeks later, he won also the Breeders' Cup. I have a friend of mine that has a horse. His name is Running Happy, and he won the Breeders' Cup, and he's at the stable where Secretariat used to be, stable one in Claiborne Farms in Kentucky. But you look at this heart, And this man, Mr. Patrick Bendave, is a multimillionaire, he's a big influencer, and I admire him very much. And he said, this came to me in a way I remember many years ago. I was in a company that I worked very hard, and they were having a big promotion. It was one of the turning points in his life where he decided to become this man that he became today. He was always very competitive, and he was at this company, and he gave the best he had and everything, and he thought he was going to win this promotion. And the day they gave the promotion, they gave it to the reunion, they gave it to somebody else. And he said, wow, correct. He's an American, born in America. I'm a foreigner. You know, he has an American name. I have a foreigner's name. The guy is from Iran. His name is Patrick Bendave. Figure it out. And he says he has the right connections. He plays sports. He played, I think, was football. The guy may be handsome. And he says, and he got the promotion. But the guy that gave him the promotion didn't see his heart. And he said he didn't see the heart of that person. And so he worked so hard with that story in his head, and he punished himself to show that he had the heart of an American Pitbull Terrier. And he pushed himself, and he created himself into the person he is today. He overpassed everybody. He overpassed the company. He just made miracles. And so that heart is gameness. Gameness is that heart. So you want that every child can be influenced by a horse like that. You want that he was influenced himself, and you want that every child is raised with a true specimen of the American Pitbull Terrier, so you can get the feedback, you can get that connection with that dog, the bond, the special bond that make you better. Because there is a process on communication in humans defined by NLP, the neuro-linguistic programming, which he says that 70% of the language is non-spoken, okay? And as being non-spoken means that children are like sponges, and they grab everything around them, you understand? So if you have a dog that's weak and cries and whatever, and you have a dog that's powerful that can mean, I'm gonna give you one more story on this particular topic about a child that has one of my dogs, Bradley. You know, he was a shy boy, and the mother tried different dogs and end up having one of my dogs because somebody told her, you got to get a dog from Chico Lopez. I see this kid falling, getting up, just wiping up his pants and running after the dog. And now he can talk to people. Now he can move. They sent me a picture of him and my dog walking into the ocean. And I look at him like a stud. You know, I said, wow, that's Bradley. The little kid didn't want to even talk or even nobody to touch him. And walking into the ocean in Galveston Beach. That influence, when you have gameness that you can project into other people, when you have gameness that you can inspire other people, that is gameness that is applied into life, into humans, and make them better. The American Pitbull Terrier has a lot to do with American success up to now.
Chico, so tell me, we just talked about gameness, and you alluded to earlier the concept of your concept of the dog man. I'm very generous with the concept because as someone that has a YouTube channel, I want to be respectful to everyone I talk to. They consider themselves dog men. I like to refer to them as dog men. I understand though with someone on, you know, with your understanding, you have a very specific definition of the concept. So share that with the audience for me, would you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I'm the same way, you know, I don't want to disrespect anybody, you know. If I have my son, you know, 5-year-old boy running around the table, the coffee table, and he has a blanket or a towel around his neck, and he says, "I'm flying, I'm Superman." I'm not gonna stop him, tell him, "Hey, you're not Superman," you know, and punish him for that. You know, I let him be. And so, you know, I guess I could do that when it comes to the term of dogman, but really, it'll be a disservice to the dog and the breed, and it'll punish the breed itself. When it comes to the American Pitbull Terrier, there are some words that are completely violated by society. Like the word pitbull is completely violated. You know, they label this, as I said before, into anything, and the word dogman as well. Let me explain to you what really is a dogman. A dogman is someone, like when you go to a company, you go to Walmart, you find somebody that's stacking merchandise, you see somebody cleaning the bathroom, you see some cashiers, you see some managers working, you have security, everything, nice people. Everybody is involved, in the business of merchandising and helping customers. They are someone involved into Walmart, but they are not the CEO of Walmart. They don't make decisions that will change and shape the future of Walmart. So when it comes to the dogman is someone that will make decisions, selection decision, has a, this is a CEO. This word was reserved for CEO. I was in the dogs already for 10 years. And some people will come and say, tell me, I said, Chico, you are like, you want to be one of the greatest dogmen who ever lived. And look how much you have accomplished. And I said, I don't consider myself to be a dogman yet. I don't know enough. I have to prove myself a little more. Maybe I go too deep into that for myself. So I measure myself with that measuring tape. But when I look back at society and I look at all the different bloodlines, you find that it was a man that created a bloodline. And you see 10,000 or 100,000 men working with those dogs. And he is the dogman, and everybody else consider themselves dogmans. Dogmans come levels. It's not a social thing. You got to get the book by Jim Collins and study that thing to understand a dogman. That's the best thing I can tell you. When you come in, you study that CEOs and leaders come in different levels, from level one to level five. You know, Iacocca, the president, the super president of the Chrysler Corporation, he couldn't have a replacement for himself, for him to be called level five leader. But then you look at Jack Welch, and this might be too much for some people. Jack Welch, when it comes to General Electric, he found, you look at, you know, Tim Cook, you know, he's a CEO that was, he replaced the great Steve Jobs. Those guys are able to develop a product like the iPhone and make it into something great that can change humanity. Those are dogmen. Those men, they are not journeymen that took some dogs and changed the bloodline and changed the flavor and was hanging around with some guys. And especially today on the forums talking, and I put myself, my name is Dogman Chico Lopez. And, you know, I own dogs for 30, 40 years. I'm a dog owner. That's who I am. I'm a dog fancier. Back in the days, the magazines would call them dog fanciers. They were dog fanciers. Now, today, for some reason, everybody's a dogman. And of course, naturally, for people that don't know American Pitbull Terriers, but they don't know the breeds, but they're watching this video, and thank you for doing so. I hope you subscribe to the channel, share it, and visit my channel, chicolopez.com. But I want you to understand something, that in any other breed, someone that has dogs and breed dogs and love dogs, they call them, oh, this guy's a cat man, this guy's a dog man. But when it comes to the American Pitbull Terrier, the word dog man is exclusive to that CEO. So between 2021 to the 1900s, there has been some level four CEO dogmen, and some level three and some level two. And those men that were able to make a progress and a change, not to their yard, not to their dogs in the yards only, but actually be able to change everything. They were influencers. They had the power to tell people what to do and what not to do. The people will listen to them. I remember walking into a place and somebody walk and say, oh, how are you? Whatever, shake hands. And then he said, this guy here is a dogman. And the guys look at each other and say, why? Because he owns dogs now, he's a dogman? What the hell? And you know, in that weather like that, they told him off and the guy couldn't say nothing. I mean, on the computer, he could say whatever he wants. But when they're face to face, oh, it's a different story. So a dogman is something that is very special. And it's a man that can make an impact in a breed. Not everyone is a dogman when it comes to the American Pitbull Terrier. Back in the year 2010 in Brazil, you know, I walk to places and people come introduce themselves, tell me I'm a dogman. You know, I have two dogs, I have three dogs. And now I find somebody, say, hey, hi, how are you, Chico? I say, hi, how are you? No, not to meet you, whatever. I say, the owner is mine. I say, I'm a dogman, you know, I know this guy, I know that other guy. I talk to him on the phone, I chat on the computer, blah, blah, blah. And he says, oh, yeah? And what are your accomplishments? What are your merits? Well, you know, I've been in the dogs for, you know, 15 years and I've done this and that. And then I started thinking, I said, Jesus Christ. You know, the guy is a nice guy. I think he had a great thing going for himself. You know, he's happy. But it bothers me that he called himself a dogman. I wouldn't do that in my times. So what I did is I created a t-shirt that got sold out quickly. And the t-shirt said, I am Chico Lopez. I am not a dogman. And so I walk into a place and people say, oh, what do you mean you're not a dogman? You're the best dogman in the world. I said, no, I'm not a dogman. You're a dogman. And it was this thing about what really is a dogman. Okay? I keep it short for you.
All right, I love that story. So like you said, a dogman is obviously someone who has a vision, a creator. You have the golden vein bloodline. Where did you come up with that name, and what is the concept behind your bloodline?
That is a beautiful story. My father was a miner. My wife's father is a miner. We come from mining set. My father would look for gold and look for other materials. Here in Brazil, we just break rocks, so it's a little different level of mining. But whenever you have a mountain full of rocks, right? Sometimes when you're looking for that gold, sometimes you find a small vein of gold, and you follow that vein, and only within that vein you have gold. You have gold, solid gold, the best of it. And in the rest of the mountains, you might have a little pockets with small, you know, inconsistent connection on these. Gold, but might not be worth it to explore the whole mountain to get to these little packets. What is worth to do is to find that golden vein and to follow that golden vein of greatness, where is the products, where the beautiful product is. So because my background of mine, I call them the golden vein. And it basically is a genetic concept of the connection of great dogs that come into a line, just like it is with gold and diamonds. And I don't know about diamonds, I know about gold. I'm sorry about that, but it comes with gold like this and continues. And you go back into the dogs and you see, well, Red Boy, okay? Father of Yellow John, father of Grand Champion Yellow. And then you say, you know, Grand Champion Yellow produce a lot of dogs, but there's only one that is really great, and he's in a cluster. That word cluster is very important. I work with this cluster. I created myself so many clusters. And so it comes to the clusters. And that dog, Grand Champion Yellow, create Grand Champion Mayday. And Mayday was bred to a lot of females and had about 4 or 5 clusters. And in the best cluster, he created a one dog that is the best dog, because I seen them with my own eyes and I touched them. A lot of people, they talk about this. I lived it. And you come and you grab this one dog called Southern Kennels Macho One Time Winner. And that right there is Golden Vein. He connects, that macho is the beginning of Golden Vein, connects with Cheyenne and creates the center of my work, Champion Awesome Buck. And you'll find this Champion Awesome Buck through my whole Golden Vein. You know, you go into Cieca de Grey, you go into Chilindrina, you go into Carmela Soprano, you go into the Backman, you go into Copperhead, Copper Day, you go into, Gasolina, you go into Mechanic Buck, you go into La Volanta, you go into, Champion Mayweather today, you go into Awesome Mayday, you go into Awesome Running, you go into all these beautiful dogs, these buckets and buckets of dogs that I produce on 1 liter. Some people could say we produce champions in every liter. It's a very good wish, boys. I do it. It's a very good wish. Consistency is the key of my success. And so the golden vein is exactly that, a consistent line of great genetics. And I'm able to take of bloodlines that are not, you know, they really was not impactful. They couldn't shine by themselves. Like the honey bunch was already washed out and went up. And I take that and within everything, the only great dog came from Chico Lopez. I mix it and I continue to create the magic because of the clinical eye. The clinical eye is looking at everything, is measuring. It's a metric that measures things. And I keep continuing creating these dogs. And what happens is a dog that has that velvet is still concept, a dog that can be your pillow and it could be your training partner, it could be your defensor. You're a woman and a dog comes in trying to attack you and the dog will defend you. He'll defend your child. So those dogs that were raised like that, that bloodline of Chico Lopez that were raised under those conditions with this part of parameter, not with a cookie cutter, not what anybody else said, only my opinion. And that create those consistent dogs that create those beautiful dogs. You know, go back to, you know, the guys in Wisdom Panel, they in shock. Like, what the hell? Where do you get a dog like this? You know, well, I got it from Chico Lopez. You're like, wow. So that's what a golden vein is. It's a collection It's a truckload of gray dogs. It's a truckload of gray dogs, legends, goats, and greats that is consistent and that is owned by one man. Something that was not made ever before like that, because every single bloodline, and I'll tell you this about bloodlines, you know, sometimes you have a bloodline, we have 10,000 strong people breeding a particular bloodline, but you have one dog. You have one person that have one dog, 30 to 40 years, and he produced one dog, and that dog is the shining star. I have trucks a load of shining stars like that. They never got to develop to become shining stars and famous to other people. Some people are famous because of their capacity in the dogs, and some people are famous because they have an open window to sell dogs to anybody. So if you have 2,000 clients, 3,000 clients, and they are saying, oh, we like this guy. So then that bloodline becomes famous because there's a lot of people saying it. I don't have that. I just don't have that. It's Chico Lopez, that's it. That's their golden vein, Chico Lopez.
So the concept of the golden vein, the lineage, that leads me into my next question, which is the importance of pedigrees and registries. Could you tell us a little bit about your understanding of pedigrees and which registry do you deal with in the American Pitbull Terrier community?
That is a very good question. Pedigrees is one of the most difficult things to deal with for people. And I got to say that I was part of it because it took me a long time to understand this. Because when you see a pedigree, most people assume that this is a guarantee instead of being a promise. So people see at a pedigree and they say, well, this is guarantee, man. This got this grand champion, and this is a good dog, and blah, blah, blah. And sometimes you have a mutt as a dog, right? So the papers, does the papers actually make a dog? Some papers do, some of the papers don't. And most people cannot even comprehend that. They're like, papers don't make a dog. And other people, oh, the importance of the pedigree. For me, it was very difficult until I really understood that everything comes in levels, you know? You find like a pedigree, one pedigree might have like so many grand champions in a pedigree, and some other pedigree might have so many grand champions. And you say, these details, this grand champion here is a super grand champion, level 5 grand champion, level 4 grand champion, level 5 grand champion. All of these is a great, solid dog. And when you look at the dog represents, he acts, he looks, he moves, he smiles the same way as the pedigree. And on the other hand, you have a dog that has some dog from somebody else, some guy that is not in the dogs anymore, some guy that is out. And you look at those levels, so this grand champion almost no grand champion, you know? And the level, so there's levels to everything, my friend. Not everything is the same. So a pedigree is only a paper that tells you where are the parents, grandparents and great-grandparents in the lineage of that particular dog. Sometimes you have a dog like I had, the first dog that I ever owned, that dog didn't have a written pedigree, and it bothered me because he didn't have one, and I felt that my dog was maybe perceived to be inferior by not having a pedigree, and it really didn't matter, because if he would have had a pedigree, his paper would have been crap. He was one of those under the umbrella, 20 million pit bulls in the United States. You know, you have a lot. Oh, my. And then some people say, like, oh, you know, I got a pedigree made out of legends. And he said, oh, like, you can put him on the wall and everything. And you have this dog, and you have that 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 dog. Well, who the hell is that dog? You know, why is he? Each dog is important, and each dog has to be work with excellence. Every dog has to have excellence. If there is no excellence, nothing happens. And then when it comes to pedigrees, quickly you can lose the quality of a great dog by a single person. Because, for instance, my dogs are going to be, they're going to promote you, and they're going to help you when you're a child and everything else. But if you're a grown man and you start to teach the dog to do bad things, that dog is going to do bad things. If you teach that dog to be a good dog and teach him good manners and good things, that dog is going to do good things. He's just a puppy. He's also like a sponge. He learns things as he go by. So if you're a solid man, that dog is going to be a solid man. If you're a solid woman, that's going to be a solid dog as well. So it happens that this is what... does a pedigree guarantee you have a great dog? Look at the pedigree. Look at the man inside the pedigree. I'm going back to the same thing I said a little while ago. Go back, look at the man in the pedigree. calibrate how good were those men were. Because if those men were not good, then the pedigree is a suspect. The men is the most important part. So who do I register with? I like to say that I have a good relationship, and I like the ADBA. I don't have any relationship or ever met the people with the UKC. You know, I have my thing with show dogs and weight pulling dogs and stuff like that. It's kind of weird because, you know, not everybody keeps the same energy. People keep changing. You know, the guy that actually gave the name to the American Pitbull Terriers was the guy that actually founded or created the UKC. But you wouldn't believe that these guys are the same as that man. You know, the way they work and their dogs, it's just dogs, you know. Somebody sent me a picture of a dog that is two dogs that are very famous. They are the top dogs in the United States, in the world, on show dogs, right? One is red, one is black. And the person is one of my fans, and he put a picture of my dog, also Mayday, when he was, I think, 3.5 years old, taking a piss. You know, he squats. A lot of my dogs squat. They don't pick up the leg like most other dogs do. What they do, I don't have an answer. But I tell you what happens. Those two dogs that had so many ribbons, walls full of ribbons and stuff, they look like chickens next to my dog. They were wimps next to my dog. And my dog is just one of my dogs. Also, Mayday is a fantastic dog. You know, he's a tremendous dog. He is a pedigree and everything else, just like out of the world. But those dogs that went through all those dog shows, that went through all those. So can you really develop? And you know, the confirmation says that, you know, we want to have judge a dog. I'm a judge. I judge numerous shows around the world. And so the confirmation is supposed to be like that. The problem with a dog show is that me as a judge, when I walk into a show, I have to judge what they bring. I cannot change anything. I cannot help them to change anything. So that's why I told them, I said, listen, I will give a seminar the day before so they can learn. And then the next day I'll give, I'll do a judging for them. And you know, you have to go to a dog show and you have to pick up the best of what they bring you. And that will be the number one against those dogs. But then those guys think this is the number one in the world. But it's only the best out of the ones that were shown. So a dog can win 10,000 ribbons, but in every show that he went, there's a circle, like a circle of people that out of every 100, the same 60 guys will show up at every show. You are beating the same guys around the world, around the country. You understand? So there's a lot of politics as well. There's a lot of people that the judges that, you know, hey man, you know, this guy's his friend. So even if you don't want to, you end up helping the guy, and that guy end up helping the other guy. So, you know, when it comes to registries, I do think that there's a tremendous positive team behind it. I support it tremendously around the world. I created clubs. I opened clubs. I literally had the leadership to go to countries and say, I want to open a club. So I'm not against it, but at the level that I am myself, it doesn't serve me any purpose. And I found out that it works in a negative way sometimes, because I'll have given a guy a first place on the ribbon. He's like, let's take a picture. Of course we're going to take a picture. Then that guy will use my image and say, you know, this dog is approved by Chico Lopez and we're selling puppies, you know. And I wouldn't approve the dog to, they couldn't give me a dog for free to come to my house. So they couldn't pay me. So I believe the registries are important. I believe that especially for those guys that they have no background, they're not real dogmen. They need to rely on somebody that'll keep a track of those dogs. Myself, today, I don't register dogs. My dogs are not registered with anybody. I don't need to have a service that registers my dogs. Maybe one day I will in the future, and if I ever do, it will be always the ADBA. I believe the ADBA was very loyal to the breed since the creation of it. I believe some of the things have changed, and I'm very sad about it. But I think that that's how the ball rolls in life, you know. At the end of the day, it's a business, and they have to work. And so the people in the Pitbulls community that raised their dogs were very too small, and you had this opportunity, this ocean of people that were breeding these dogs that came from deformed Pitbulls, and created a new breed called, supposed to be breed, of dogs called Bully. And so they started to raise their bullies. And when that came about, I was very sad about it. I spoke with them about it. And then with time, kind of like, I wouldn't say the friendship fade off because I still like them very much, but I think the communication kind of fade off. And so I don't need anybody registering my dogs. I am at the level where it's just, you know, I'm like they say, the guardian of the breed, the guardian of the standard. So I do have the dog that's the standard. The standard of the breed for the ADBA was created by a man called Dale Brastrom. He's a good friend of mine, he's 86 years old. Tremendous intellect. He hasn't seen a dog in 35 years or so. And we talk about life and other things. And he did a drawing for the original ADBA confirmation. The confirmation standard, he wrote it himself for his best friend, Ralph Greenwood, which is the person that bought the registry the last time. You know, since then, he's Ralph Greenwood. It is the Greenwood family that runs it, which I have a lot of appreciation for them as well, especially a few members. And I have to say that, you know, this man, we were looking at different pictures from different dogs, you know, working dogs and show dogs. And he said, what happened, man? And then all of a sudden he saw a picture of one dog and he said, wow, I really like the dog. And then he saw a picture of this female and he said, this is the most beautiful dog I've ever seen. I never saw a dog like this. And he says, you know anything about this dog? And I look at him, I look at my wife and I looked at him and I says, yes, that's my dog. He said, really? That's your dog? I said, yeah, that's my dog. His name is Sierra the Great. She's not only a you know, you like the standard. Said, this is the standard. This is the standard of the American Pitbull Terrier. I haven't seen a dog that's beautiful like this. And I said, how will you compare this dog to the original dog? And he said, no. This dog is the standard of the American Pitbull Terrier. So I have dogs that are not only beautiful, they're not only the golden vein, but also the man that created the standard for that registry, which I like. I don't have nothing to say bad to them. I just think that they made a business move that is not for me, you understand? And so I have a dog that represents the standard of the American Pitbull Terrier. That's why even before he said it, some of the people that have ADBA shows, ADBA clubs, they took that picture and put all the linings, you know, the right angulation, the right, perfect dog. And so my dogs have this as a grandmother, as a great-grandmother, as a great-great-grandmother. This dog is part of my center. And this is, once again, why these golden vein dogs are so special. And so I do believe that the pedigree is great when the man that created the pedigree is great. If the man is a whole bunch of men, then you have to question it. Then you have to go into consistency. Then you have to go back and look at the dog and say, where is the metrics around this dog? Where is everything around this dog? Where is everything that make it? Oh, but this dog here belonged to that guy. So how many guys you got involved in the process of this one puppy? 10,000 guys to give me a puppy? You see, if you got 10,000 guys working, then it's not good. Because the chances are too little bit. 10,000 people, how many breedings? And when you went back at the beginning of history and you went to a particular man, that man had his dogs. You were buying a dog from him that was his dog. You understand? So you need to have this, you know, you have 10,000 people, you have the standard idea of 10,000 different men. So for me, it's very important. I believe if I would have to say, what do you think the ratios are important? I'll say use the ADBA. If you have to have a dog register, the ADBA. If your dog is already registered with the UKC and not registered with the ADBA, I'll say go with the UKC. I don't have nothing against them. They have their own cookie cutter thing and stuff. They call them pit bulls for whatever reason. And some people are doing that. That's fine. I'm not going to hate on that. I'm not going to hate on anything. But I'm going to say this. If I had to choose, I'd choose the ADBA. How about the other registries that are coming up? Like people opening. It's a business. You know, opening a business and doing it. If the man that opened that business is someone that, I don't know, I wouldn't use it. Why would I use something that just came up when I can use the ADBA? You know, was founded in, I think it was 1809. I'll stick to the ADBA if I had to. But me, myself, today, Chico Lopez, don't need to raise the dogs. And I explain to you why. The signature, no disrespect to nobody. The signature on that birth certificate that I give, and it has the signature of Chico Lopez, is way more powerful, more valuable than any registry some guy on a desk is going to put. Absolutely. By miles, there's no way to to say it differently. That's my opinion.
Okay, sir. Okay. Let me ask you this. So my next question was, I was going to ask you, was going to be about your breeding philosophy. But in talking to you, I feel like a better question would be, because you say, you know, the dog is a representation of the man, the breeder. So instead of asking you what your breeding philosophy is, please explain to me what your philosophy as a person, as a man is, and how does that maintain the essential nature of the American Pitbull Terrier in your breeds, and your dogs, I'm sorry.
I don't know if I understood the question. It sounds a little bit complex, but I'm going to give my best.
Let me try again. What I understood. You said that, you know, when you look at a dog, you're looking at the man. So I don't, yes. I'm not going to ask you about the dogs this time, because I want you to tell me about the man.
Okay.
And then I will understand the dogs.
I understood now. When I was a little boy, and I went 5 years old, went to school, I was the number one guy in my class. When I went to second grade and I was 6 years old, I couldn't go back to classes because I didn't have shoes. And so the teacher came home and find out how come he's not coming. He said, he's embarrassed, he has no shoes. And they had to work that out and find me some shoes so I can go. When I was in kindergarten, my best picture, I'm actually wearing a shirt that was given to me by a Canadian lady that I didn't know that was a girl's shirt. So I was always very competitive and everything was stacked against me. When I was 16 years old in New York City on a winter, very bitter winter cold, December, January, and I was homeless and it was very difficult. And I made it from being homeless, supporting my family, and I won. When I was a Boy Scout at the age of 11 years old, I became the first Eagle Scout in my country. I went from my poor country as being a little boy, and back then economics was a lot different than today. Flying around the world was a lot different today. And they flew me to Australia to a World Jamboree back in 1986, 87, I believe. And I won the competition of the, you know, making the nuts, the Boy Scout nuts. And I was a person that I always prepared. I remember that I never knew that I was going to go to that event. It was a surprise. I mean, we barely have food to eat, and all of a sudden, my scout guide come to the house and says, "Your son being selected by the national committee to be the one Boy Scout that's going to represent us." And I was in shock. Then they selected me to be someone to be one of the 11 Boy Scouts for the Columbus Project, the 500th anniversary discovery of the New World. And I was always very impactful. I created my own troop when I was a Boy Scout called Garrobos, and it became the most successful troop that ever lived, exist in Honduras. We were legends there, and people will take the, you know, I came out of the newspaper, so they take these new things, and every time they talk about somebody, they always remember me as a Boy Scout. I was so dedicated, and we didn't have a family, like parents organization to help us. We had to finance everything ourselves. So we created a newspaper in the community at the age of 12 years old. And that newspaper, we found the machine, somebody gave it to us, we bought the ink, we bought this, and we created a newspaper with the advertising for the neighborhood. At the time, it was something big. Of course, looking back now, it was kind of small, but with the things that we had in the hands, it was very difficult. You know, I live in a junkyard, and they live in a car in a junkyard, and they'll pay me $20 to go get a radiator or get something out of a car. So it was very difficult. And then you look at me, I had traveled the whole world many times, in and out, spending a lot of money from family and doing a lot of great things for the breed. I'm someone that always want to lift somebody. The people that were in my club of the Boy Scouts, you know, friends from 34 years ago, they look up to me. They're all engineers, they're all architects, they're all top-of-the-line people. My circle of friends is always going to be on the, you know, I'm going to have people that are in government. I'm going to have people that are very powerful economically. And they all respect me, respect my opinion. They ask me for advice all the time. So I am a CEO of my life. I'm a winner. I make a lot of mistakes. I'm not perfect, but I learn a lot from those mistakes. But I think adversity is a good way to say it. I believe that if life would have been a race, I was born and they put some leather boots on me. I mean, not leather boots. They put some cement boots and say, "Go ahead, man, start running." and it was difficult, but we made it. And this is the man who I am. I really don't hate anybody. I used to, at the beginning, I guess, make me angry, but the level of something called hate is too difficult. So I don't hate anybody. I know some people might hate me for, they don't like my opinion, or they might not like my approach or my knowledge or my success or who I am, or, you know, some people live in a bubble, you know, and it's nothing wrong with that. That's how they learn. And I understand that. And all of a sudden come in this guy that has a big pedigree as a dog man, and his dogs are better and everything's better, and tell them that's the wrong way to do it. And that person might be doing that for 20 years, 30 years. And all of a sudden they become angry because of that, you know? And so for me, I believe on lifting other people. I believe on preserving the American Pitbull Terrier. American Pitbull Terrier is going to be finished. There's nothing left. And the reason why there's nothing left is because there's no ecosystem. The ecosystem that was available in the 90s, the golden era of the American Pitbull Terrier extends from the 70s to 2010. And then outside of the United States, it continues for the next maybe 10 years more. No, 7-8 years more. And it's finished. What United States have, United States at one time, they used to call that the game, which I think it was stupid, but anyhow, it was called the game. And that converted today into what is called the swamp. So, you know, I'm a historian. I'm a person that like to observe things, like to see things, like to analyze and look at things and help people. That's why I'm a winner. I like to win. I like to be able to lift. I think that one of my biggest mistakes in life, it has been that I'm very pragmatic in one area, super pragmatic. And in another area, I'm very passionate, super passionate. And in another area, I have a very good heart. And I think that this good heart many times have clouded my pragmatic side and my logic. And I have gone through the heart, and I have helped people sometimes, especially in the dogs, that later on are, you know, they get angry when the truth come up about them or something like that. And so, but I have people that I have helped in the dogs, and they love me for life. I mean, I have friends that I'll put in my books, because I'm going to write books, a few books. And those friends' testimonial will go out to say, wow, Chico has done great. I have implemented things in the world of the American Pitbull Terrier that are part of the American Pitbull Terrier. And even this video here right now will bring an understanding that we're lifting whatever is left of the breed. And it's kind of funny, because what happens is, you know, back in 1990, when I got into the dogs were going up. They were going up. I guess it's this way. They were going up. They were going up, up, up. And all of a sudden, they start to go down. And I continue to go up, to go up. And actually, I went like this in a quantum leap. So I am that person. I am a person that I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't do drugs of any type. I appreciate people. I appreciate the quality. Huh? I'm actually a sugar holic, I guess. And my wife is laughing here. And but I'm trying to fix that problem, because it created a lot of problems in my life, the sugar, the love of sugar and things like that. But I'm generally a very good person. I believe that the people that know me personally, the majority get to love me and like me. You know, I go to a different country and people will put me in a 5-star hotel. Or if they have a mansion, they'll say, Chico, I want you to stay here with us and stay near the children and stuff like that. I believe that if you bring me to another country and you put me into your home, you have a super house, and you bring me there and let me stay with your children, meet your mother and father, I'm a good guy. I believe that I'm a good person. That's who I am. Beautiful. Now you can ask my wife. My wife will tell you I'm the greatest man in the world, right?
Well, she's standing by your side, so that's a great sign that she believes in you. I'm going to...
My friend, it's a beautiful story. If I tell you how we met and how our life has been, it's like unbelievable. You know, I tell you one thing before we go to the next question. My life, as pragmatic and detail-oriented and looking for excellence has been, it is so amazing that some of the facts in my life has been like a beautiful Forrest Gump story. It's unbelievable how it happened. I mean, how do you figure... And, you know, 20-year-old kid in New York, you know, wearing a suit and tie. You know, when I first walked and met the American Pitbull Terrier, I actually had a suit and tie. I was not some of those guys, you know, whatever. And so I was already a very educated person. And so I consider myself to be on a high level for what is available, I got to say, you know, for what is available. A person that is very executive for the American Pitbull Terrier. These pictures of me with dogs, and that doesn't mean that I don't get dirty. Of course I get dirty. Of course I'll pick up the crap of my dogs in my own hands, you know. Of course I play with them. Of course I play with my puppies. Of course I take care of my dogs. Of course I sleep with my dogs. You know, I love my dogs like nothing else in the world. And but I am that person, my friend. I am that person. I take it very seriously, yeah.
Sir, before we start an interview, you said you had some dogs. You had some puppies you wanted to show me. Are they available?
I just told my wife she gets ready. I don't know. We'll give you some pictures that you can post right here in the video of those dogs, I guess, because my wife didn't. We'll have to go grab the puppies. The noise will be incredible. The noise will be incredible. You know.
Right. Well, let me ask you real quickly. I'm going to wrap this up because I think we said a lot, and I think we probably should do this again. There's a lot of questions I didn't get to, but one of the biggest things that I wanted to talk to you about was the fact that the American Pitbull Terrier is a breed that some say is being displaced by modern society. I think you, as an advocate, an ambassador, expert on the breed, you probably the most well-equipped person to tell me what is the future of the breed, and how, and what do we do? I mean, I know you're doing a lot of work yourself, but what do we do? What do I do as an influencer, as someone that has a YouTube channel dedicated to informing the world about dogs? What do we do to secure the future of this breed?
My friend, you know, that is a very powerful question, and there is really no easy way to answer that question. First of all, we'll have to define what is a pitbull. And this was from the very beginning. You know, you have a huge umbrella of dogs that have sparkles of the American Pitbull Terrier that people call them pitbulls. And for them, sadly, they already have established an image in their heads of what is a pitbull. And the image that they have of a pitbull is not a real pitbull. It is not a real pitbull. And for some other people, the bad experience that they had with those dogs that are not real pit bulls, they don't come from a great super dogman or from some responsible person, and they get beaten or have got bad raps from those dogs, they give the breed a really bad name. And then on top of that, television and the media is very use the pit bulls as something very sensationalized the dogs and stuff like that. A lot of times they do it to cover up other issues that they have bigger in the country. And so I do believe there is bad people, of course. I'm not going to say that, you know, I'm not, you know, a lot of people call me, it's like, oh man, I'm a breeder. Can I get a dog from you? I say, no, you're never going to get a dog from me. I don't sell to breeders. I do not sell to breeders. I work with people that I interview, and that person has to be a little bit like me or a hero within his family, has to be a goat in a particular sport or be attached to the goat or be somebody that's good. Because my motto is connecting the greatest dog that ever lived, Chico Lopez's Golden Vein, with the greatest people. So what is the future of the dogs if we have this umbrella of dogs that doesn't fit onto this program? These dogs that have sparkles, that were bred, that you go, you know, you go in a negative domino, you know, domino chain effect, go like ta 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 ta, like this, going in negative, like going backwards, negative, and you go through all the years, and all of a sudden, bam, you find a picture of that dogman or that dog person selling a dog to somebody, and 30, 40, 50 generations later, you see these dogs in the hands of criminals, in the hands of bad people, and sometimes in the hands of good people that don't know. Listen, there's a lot of good people that, because of their culture, they believe, oh my God, I want to see my grandsons coming out of my daughter, my grandsons coming out of my son, and that's very normal for humans. But they don't understand that it's not normal for dogs. In this thing that we created of having a dog as a pet, we have magnified this to create these dogs pets as we love them. But it's like one step below a son for some people. Maybe for me, yes, it is the same. But for some people, is you know, they think that dog has to have puppies. And that is the problem. You know, there's no future with that. And that's the reason why all these dog they call pit bulls. I consider the majority to be mutts, and I don't mean to be disrespectful to nobody. Please forgive me if I offend you, because I don't want to offend you. But I'm just saying the facts. Don't hate the messenger. I know the facts. And so these dogs, they go down the line, and they keep breeding them. You know, they somebody gets a puppy, and then somebody else get the opposite sex. They breed them, and 5 years later, you have a whole bunch of puppies. You know, you get 10 puppies on 1 liter. Those 10 puppies have 6, 7, 8 puppies, each one of them. And down the line, boom, 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 and you have another 150, 200 dogs. And you repeat that in all United States all the time. So you have homeless dogs. You have dog problems. You have shelters full of dogs all the time. I have a lady call me. He says, I adopted a pit bull, and the dog is in the room right now, in the bathroom. I have to lock him in because he wants to bite me. I said, well, that's not a pit bull. You adopted the dog. There's no way you can adopt a pit bull. You adopted a pit bull type dog. That's not a real pit bull. And she said, the dog just wants to eat me. And, you know, he passed this good titties and thing and all this stuff. I don't want these dogs to die. Honestly, I don't want to, you know, but stop breeding dogs. There's no future on breeding dogs. There's no future. And you know, they're confusing zebras with donkeys, you know. They're confusing something exotic with a donkey. And it's a society problem. It's a culture problem. It was created by society by not having the right mentors, as you said before, as not having. You know, some people come in and says, hey, Chico, how you doing, man? I want to preserve the American Pitbull Terrier. I said, what? Tell me, what do you know? He said, well, you know, I want you to teach me. I want to get these and I want to get that. I have some guy that taught me. I want to get your dogs. I want to get a yard started. You want to get a yard started? I don't work with breeders at all. Zero. I have nothing for a breeder. And the reason why I don't is it might have been a great business for me. But you must understand that I love the breed and I lose money every single day. I'll tell you something, I'm a badass salesman. I work in sales all my life and customer service, and I'm a great salesman, but I cannot sell my dogs. I'm the worst guy selling my dogs. I don't sell my dogs. If I had great people, all of them, yes, I will do it. But a breeder wants to get the dogs to breed them. You know, there was a wave on bullies, and now I think people are starting to realize that the bullies have diseases and they get sick and whatever. One of my dogs, Ernie, when they did some genetic test, and you know, the test came back, zero genetic disease, zero mutations, zero this, zero that, super healthy. My dogs are so healthy, they die 13, 14 years old, and they never sick, you know? I don't have to go to a doctor because my dog is sick or because he has some problems with the bone structure. And my dogs can run forever, you understand? So what's the future of the breed? If we don't define what is the breed, we need to define what is the breed. There is a few dogs that compose the real breed. These dogs that we have out there in the street, the 20 million dogs that they have, that they call pit bulls, those dogs will go for the next 300 years. They will keep breeding those dogs. The real American Pit Bull Terrier has no future. And the reason why that dog has no future, and it's a very sad story. I mean, I cried about it before. I thought about it and everything. The reason why it doesn't have future is because, for one side, there is not enough genetic material that we will have to stop everybody breeding dogs, and we'll have to have some CEO level of intelligence, of dedication, people that will take some really great genetic material and start to work and have the same culture of, if you buy a dog, you keep a dog as a pet. I have people that call me and say, I want to buy a dog. They ask me, who will buy a dog without having the rights to breed it? In that little world of pit bulls, you know, they think that there's no people that can have a dog. They'll have the dog until the dog dies and buy another dog. Of course, there are. Most of the people are like that. They'll get a dog and they'll have it and they want to get another dog. So what are we preserving? Are we taking a donkey, or are we taking a horse and we say, I got an elephant, but it's a horse. And he said, I want to preserve the elephants. Well, you got a horse. So do you have a real pit bull to preserve that pit bull? You don't have a real pit bull. And that is the problem. How can you preserve a real pit bull if you don't have the real pit bull? How can you preserve the real pit bull if you don't have the culture to preserve that pit bull? You got to have a culture. You got to understand everything in order for you to. I wish this happened. I believe that I have the most fantastic American Pitbull Terriers on the planet, and I'm willing to to have this debate and this conversation about why my dogs are the greatest dogs in the world. I mean, look at the people that own my dogs. You know, I try my best. Maybe some sleek bag told me that he's a great family member, a great father, a great person, and maybe he's not who he say he was. Maybe he did sign a contract with me, and maybe he's not a good person, but I can't control people. I do the very best I can, but I know that most of my dogs, the people that have them, they are friends of mine. And I want this. I want someone that will buy a dog from me. It'll be someone that can call me and ask him for an advice, exclusive information, exclusive help, you know, that can help him. And I want to get pictures. I want to get these because I want a great community of great, healthy people that I have the dogs. And they can, we can showcase the best dogs in the best position possible to people. But people always imitate everything, my friend. I created the word. I started using it. I didn't create it, but I'm the one that used it, made it very popular. Real Pitbull, my friend. They took the word and went with it. So for me, my information, I have a Pitbull University. It's called, you go to Chico Lopez, and you'll find the link to Pitbull University. And in Pitbull University, I try to teach people. I have guys that say, listen, why don't you show more dogs? Why are you always talking about dogs rather than show dogs? My dogs, you can go to my Instagram, you see my dogs. You see my dogs engaging with people, engaging with other dogs, engaging with other animals, engaging with their owners and with friends, with neighbors. You can see them there. But if you want to learn about the American Pitbull Terrier, then the Pitbull University, I have it in Spanish and English, Universidad del Pitbull. And then you can see that. Unfortunately, the American Pitbull Terrier, the only way we can preserve it is I have a plan that I've been working on for a long, long time to, in my case, or my position with the dogs that I have, I'm talking about nobody else, I'll die somewhere around between 75 to 85 if God wants me to do that. I hope he does bless me with that life up to about 80, 85 years old. I have mentored and helped people through all my life and have put a great solid foundation of dogs with different people as pets. And then I have some genetics that I leave with the family and maybe a few friends. And those people can use that after my death, and they can go for another 30 to 40 years. And after that, then the dogs that I have, some people that I have no control, they might try to read my books and preserve those dogs in some way, and that they are trying to gain knowledge on what was the Chico was looking for on a puppy, and, you know, to breed it. You understand? Even with me, I don't breed every dog I have. I don't breed every female I have. For a stud dog to become someone that I'm going to breed, he has to be a best dog. So I do have consistency, and the whole litter is great. But when I'm coming to breed, the other puppies will not be bred. They're all great. But when I'm coming for me to breed, there are things that I'm looking for. You understand? And some of my dogs that I gave away and I sold, I don't sell a lot of people's, you know, dogs, 30 to 40 puppies maximum a year. And I haven't done it for just a few years. But what I want to say is that I know exactly where I put those little gems that among all those dogs, I really like them. And someday they know that if I need it, I'll go back and try to get some of those genetics. And of course, you have the breeders walking on the walls like Spider-Man and calling me. I have guys that call me. And the lady called me, an older lady. Oh, I'm looking for a particular dog, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, my God. You know, how old are you, mom? You remind me asking, no, I'm 68 years old. And asking me about pedigree, particular dogs. And I can hear the guy whispering on the ears. And I'm like, why don't you put him on the phone? Oh, man, I'm not going to do this. Embarrassing. You do it yourself. Hey, man, yeah. And, you know, it is really like that. You know, the people that are involving the dogs are the worst thing that ever happened to dogs sometimes. There are so few men that are very special, that have nothing but love for them. And I'm pretty sure there are very nice people out there that are on that umbrella of regular pitbull type dogs. There are great people, they just don't know the truth. You understand? And it's sad that they don't know the truth. I think I would have been one of those guys if I wouldn't have that man that told me, don't go for that big old head, super. They were developing the bullies back then. You gotta remember, the time that I've been in the dogs, it's more likely, by the time I got everything that happened 10 years, got to the dogs, it was fresh. It was the fresh news. You know, you're living right now what was fresh 5, 6, 7 years ago, and the breed is about 10 years. And so they were leaving that. I broke the tradition of, and they, people call me and say, man, the dogs you have, and you don't share them with the people. No, no, I won't share them. You know, every great CEO in the American Pitbull Terrier breed, whether it was level 3, dogman, level 4, whatever, level 2, they always took those dogs and throw them to anybody that can come with a dollar, not Chico Lopez. Because I am the last one, and I'm going to preserve these dogs for the best people. I want the great children of the future to have great dogs and leave this heritage for them. And that's the story, my friend.
Well, what I wanted to say to you, Mr. Lopez, is that you, to me, this is the essence of what I started this channel for. This is actually the essence of this channel. You know, I have a YouTube channel, which is a community open to billions of people. And we get a lot of information and a lot of opinion left in the comment section. We get a lot of information and opinion left on other videos. One of the things that I always believed about Dogumentary TV and Bully Badass TV before that is that it wasn't going to be centered around my personality or my personal knowledge. My expertise is filmmaking, and I have a degree in communications. That's my expertise. So I always wanted to search out and find people who have a real connection, a real relationship, a lived experience with the breed. I think today that this interview demonstrates that you are one of the, if not the most important person to the American Pitbull Terrier today. I want to thank you. It's been 2 hours. We didn't get to everything I wanted to talk to you about today, so maybe we can maybe do this again sometime in the future. Let the audience digest this. Let them, if they have questions that they felt weren't answered by you, maybe we can do this again. Again, I want to really, really from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Interviews like this are really kind of the backbone of this channel. A lot of times when I started, I would just have these conversations over the phone, and I wasn't able actually to have bring them to the audience. Fortunately, the technology has changed, and this is possible now for me, or I'm aware of it. So I hope you guys who are watching this understand that what you saw was something that was real. It's not internet propaganda. No. It's not a bunch of talk. Nope. It's a man who's lived it. Whether you agree with him or disagree with him, I hope that you respect him, and that you have, if you have a disagreement, that you're respectful and objective in your disagreement. That's, as grown people, we all have the right to our opinion. We don't have a right to our own facts. So we got to respect when we're speaking about opinion versus facts, and we should be respectful. So I look forward to what you guys have to see in the comment section. Like I said, this is what this channel is about. Mr. Lopez took 2 hours today to talk to you guys and give you his first person experience with the breed. I think what you see in Mr. Lopez is a lot of passion, commitment, and dedication to the breed. Agree or disagree, please respect that. Respect that he's been, at this point, you know, very generous in sharing that information with you guys. I want to thank you again very much, sir. I appreciate you. We'll be talking to you again very soon.
You know, absolutely. And I appreciate the people. Like I said, I don't have any agenda towards anybody. I believe that one thing that I got to tell you before we go is that, you know, I went through a 30-year journey to get where I'm at right now. And it's not propaganda or anything like that, because I don't need it. You know, I decline so many people. But imagine that a school teacher or a school principal will buy a puppy from me, and he'll have the very best dog that I couldn't have 30 years ago without having to go through everything that I've gone through. And so I think it's a blessing that I'm able to do that. The life empowered me, the work empowered me to do that. But my intentions is not to smash anybody. You know, maybe at one point in my life, in the past, maybe so, I had some wanting to smash somebody about doing the wrong thing. But today, I believe exactly what you said. People are entitled to their opinion. And I just tell you one thing. When you are looking for an opinion, if you're going to have a surgery, open heart surgery, you need to have the very best doctor in the world with the best pedigree to give you his opinion. You cannot ask a mechanic. You cannot ask a nurse what is her opinion or his opinion. You got to get the right man to give you that opinion. And that's why some people say, oh, I want to give my 2 cents. Well, sometimes your 2 cents are not welcome here in the topic, because here we're dealing with $100 bills, and just to put it in context. And so people can talk about just reading books, and people can talk about just, I know some guy, I know a few of the guys who have been around. I actually gone around the world several times and have trucks or loads of great, amazing legends. And this experience and this video right here is a gift from me to the world, for them to understand the American Pitbull Terrier, to embrace it, to love it. You don't need to do anything illegal, because you don't have anything to add to your life or the life of the dogs. Do not confuse a cheap dog fighter with a dogman. Don't do that, okay? And there's no dogmans anymore. So, you know, we're people that love ourselves, and we always think very good of ourselves. If we don't have the merits, we're really not that. I want to tell you thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to express myself, and you and I working together to try to help other people, to try to leave their understanding of the breed. So I think that's very important. So myself, want to tell you, on behalf of me and my wife, want to tell you thank you ourselves. And let's see how that works. And if they like it, we might be coming back for another one.
Okay, guys, thank you so much. Sorry about that. I had an issue with the volume. I want to say this has been, like I said, a very essential part of what I think this channel should be about. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you guys would, please, if you haven't already, if you come to this channel because you saw the Chico Lopez in the title, subscribe to the channel. It's not just, this channel is not just about American Pitbull Terrier. It's about all dog breeds. It's a place where you can learn and become more aware of dogs in general, all dog breeds. I try to do as many different dog breeds as I can do. I'm trying to get to all of them eventually. All right, guys, thanks a lot. This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. Peace.